ഹലോ മൈ ഡിയർ ചിൽഡ്രൻ, വെൽക്കം ഓൾ ഓഫ് യു ടു ദ സെക്കൻഡ് എപ്പിസോഡ് ഓഫ് ദ കെമിസ്ട്രി സെക്ഷൻ ഓഫ് അവർ ബേസിക് സയൻസ് ക്ലാസ്. വി ഹാവ് സ്റ്റാർട്ടഡ് അവർ ഫസ്റ്റ് ചാപ്റ്റർ, പ്രോപ്പർട്ടീസ് ഓഫ് മാറ്റർ, ഇൻ ദ പ്രീവിയസ് ക്ലാസ്. ആൻഡ് ത്രൂ സെർട്ടൻ ആക്ടിവിറ്റീസ് വി ഹാവ് ലേൺഡ് വാട്ട് ഇസ് കോൾഡ് എ മാറ്റർ. ഓക്കെ, വാട്ട് വാസ് ഇറ്റ്? യെസ്, എനിത്തിങ് വിച്ച് ഓക്യുപ്പൈസ് സ്പേസ് ആൻഡ് ഹാസ് മാസ് ഈസ് കോൾഡ് മാറ്റർ. So, whatever we see around, whatever objects are there around us, all are called matter. Why? Because all these have mass and they occupy space. They need space to exist. And regarding this, a small assignment was given to you to list out maximum number of objects and tabulate them according to the state of existence. Three states, isn't it? We discussed about three physical states of matter: solid state, liquid state, and gaseous state. Okay, I know all of you have tabulated maximum number of objects under these three headings. Also, we learned an important and basic concept of chemistry, that all substances are made of tiny particles which cannot be seen with our eyes, and these tiny particles possess the properties of that substance. Do you remember that experiment we had done in the previous class? Yes, of course. It was with sugar crystals and potassium permanganate crystals. We dissolved them in 2 beakers of water. Yes, very good. So we arrived at the concept that all substances are made of very tiny particles. So all the substances we see around are called matter, and these exist in three different states: solid, liquid, and gas. Have you ever wondered why is it so? Why are some objects in solid state, the others in liquid, and at others in gaseous state? Can you give the reason for that? Okay, don't worry. In today's class, we shall find the answer for this question. Are you ready? Okay. In order to find the answer of this question, let's examine some situations closely. Like, see, we can dissolve sugar or salt in water. Second one, we can dip a glass rod or a spoon in water. Third one, we can wave our hands. Please, all of you, wave your hands and say hi to me. Okay, thank you. And the fourth one, we cannot wave our hands through a book or say a cardboard. Read the situations once again. We can dissolve sugar or salt in water. We can dip a spoon or a glass rod in water. We can wave our hands easily. We cannot wave our hands through a book or a cardboard. Can you explain these situations? Oh, some of you might be thinking that this teacher is going on giving questions and questions without giving an answer. Is it so? Already we have a question, isn't it? What was that? We have to find out why certain objects are solids, certain others appear to be liquid, and certain others appear to be gases. We have to find the answer for that question. So, dear children, if we can explain these situations correctly, surely we can arrive at the answer of that question. Okay, so we'll see the situations once again. First one, we can dissolve sugar in water. That is, sugar is soluble in water. Water is in liquid state, you know that. And sugar, what is the state of sugar? Yes, solid state. That means we can put a solid into a liquid, and that solid is very well soluble in that liquid. Because we have seen in that activity that after some time the sugar crystals are not seen. That becomes a sugar solution. There is a sugar in that solution. Okay. The second one, we can dip a rod, glass rod or spoon in water. Spoon or glass rod are again solids. These solids can be dipped very well into a liquid. And third one, yes, waving our hands. So tell me, what is there around me or around you? Of course, there is air around us. We know that. And air is in gaseous state. We can easily wave our hands or we can stand or sit in air, right? Okay. The last situation was, we cannot wave our hands through a book or cardboard or such a solid state object. So we have to explain these situations. Why is it possible that sugar can be dissolved in water, spoon can be dipped into water, we can wave our hands, we cannot wave our hands through a book or any other solid state object? Let me ask you one thing. How do scientists make discoveries? How do scientists make new discoveries? Of course, experiment, yes, I heard that. They do experiments. They analyze the observations of that experiment. They do several calculations. And after all these, they come up with a new discovery. But in some cases, scientists assume something before they do experiments. That means they make some assumptions or predictions before they conduct an experiment. Okay. Yes, they make some assumptions that this may be the reason. And then they go for proving that through their experiments. Let's take these statements as our assumptions. We are also going to assume something. Okay. Just read these assumptions. Particles have a distance between them. Particles can move continuously. Particles attract one another. Have you read these assumptions? Okay, these are our assumptions. And now we are going to prove it. Okay. Here the particles means, very good, of course we have come across that. We know that all substances are made of tiny particles. And these are some of the features of that particles. So, in our first situation, sugar being added and dissolved in water. Water is a substance, we know. Sugar is also a substance. So that means water has tiny particles of water in it. Also, sugar has tiny particles of sugar in it. And as per our first assumption that particles have a distance between them, if the water particles have a distance between them, there will be a gap in between them, right? There will be space in between them. And the tiny particles of sugar can occupy these gaps. In a second situation, a spoon or glass rod being dipped into water, of course, if the water particles have space in between them or if they have a distance between them, surely we can dip anything into it, isn't it? So we have got an idea of how the particles in water will be or in any liquid will be. How is it? Yes, the particles of a liquid will be having some space in between them, or particles in liquids have a distance between them. Okay, shall we examine our third situation? What was that? Yes, we can easily wave our hand in air, isn't it? And what about water? Can we wave a hand in water? Surely you know about swimming. Okay. So in air, it is more easy to wave a hand, isn't it, than waving a hand in water. So does it not mean that the particles of air have more distance between them? Do you agree with me? I repeat, the air particles or the particles of air have more space between them than the particles in a liquid. And that is why we can easily wave our hand in air. Okay. Now, our fourth situation. What was that? We cannot wave a hand through a book or a cardboard or a solid substance. If there was space between the particles of a solid, we can easily wave our hand. So that means the particles of solid do not have space in between them. Then how will it be? Yes, the particles of a solid will be much closer to each other. That means there is no space in between them. Isn't it? Okay. So we have analyzed our first assumption. And according to our situation, we got that in solids, the particles do not have distance between them. In liquids, of course, the particles are a bit far apart. There is a little distance between the particles in liquid, and in gases, the distance between the particles are much more. Okay. Now, our second assumption. What was that? Particles can move continuously. Let me ask you one thing. Can a solid
move by itself?
Can a solid substance
move by itself?
No, isn't it? Usually no. Okay. If there is a slope or a gravitational pull, of course, the answer will be different. Usually, a solid substance cannot move on its own. What about liquids? Yes, we can see liquids flowing, isn't it? That means the particles are free to move. Whereas in solids, the particles are not free to move. And what about gases? Just imagine we are taking a gas in a container, and if the lid is open, yes, the gas will escape or move out all of a sudden. That means the particles in a gas can move much more freely. They can move continuously. Let's move on to our third assumption. What was it? Particles attract one another. Attraction. You are familiar with the attraction of? Oh, very good. Magnet and iron objects. Okay. Magnets attract iron objects, iron made objects. And you like to play with magnets, right? Okay. So, if a magnet and an iron object is kept far away, will it attract? No, isn't it? Both has to be brought near at a particular distance. Likewise, now you tell me, in which of these states particles can attract each other? If the particles have to attract each other, the distance between them should be much less. And in which state is it possible? Very good. In solid states, as the particles are much closer to each other, how will be the attraction? Very good. The attraction between them will be more. The particles of a solid substance attract one another. What about liquids? There is a little distance between the particles in a liquid, so the attraction will be less. And coming to gases, yes, the particles are very far apart, so the attraction will be very, very, very less. Okay, now we have got an idea of how the particles are existing in these three states of objects, right? To make these concepts more clear, look at this clip. This is actually an animation of the picture given in your textbook, figure 4.4 of page number 57. See, a solid substance is coming out of that container. It is a solid substance. See, those balls, small balls represent the particles in that substance. Okay. Actually, in the real world, The tiny particles are not seen with our eyes. We know that. But for explaining our concept, imagine these small balls represent the tiny particles in a substance. Okay. Now, see how that solid is coming out? Is there any space between the particles? No, isn't it? Now, the next one. This is a liquid coming out of that container. Is it in the same way as the solid is coming out? No. Imagine this is a gas coming out of the container. Oh, the particles have escaped before I have finished my sentence, right? Okay. So now, have you got an idea of how the particles are in solids, liquids and gases? Okay, please tell me now. Yes, the arrangement of particles in different objects of solids or liquids or gases are different. In solids, they are arranged very close to each other, or we can say they are tightly packed or closely packed. In liquids, there is a little distance between the particles. The particles are free to move. And in gases, the particles have much more distance between them and they are very free to move. They move continuously. Okay. I can see smiles on your face now. Yes, you have got the answer for our question, isn't it? Now, how will you answer that question now? Why do objects appear to be solid, liquid or gas? Very good. It is because of the difference in arrangement of particles in them. Okay. This difference in the arrangement of particles in different objects make them appear as solids or liquids or gases. Are you happy? Okay. So, dear children, we have arrived at a very important concept in science. Okay. We know that all objects can be called matter. Matter exists in three different states. And now we have find out the reason of why certain objects are solids, certain others are liquids, and certain others are gases. Why? Yes, it is because of the difference in the arrangement of particles in them. Okay. Now, shall we move on to an activity? Actually, this activity is a very common practice. See, ice cubes are taken in this beaker. What will happen if it is kept as such? Very good. It will melt and become water. Okay. What will happen if we heat that ice cubes? Okay. If we heat the beaker containing ice, it will melt more faster. Yes, we know that. See, now the ice has been melted. It has become water now. Still we are going on heating it. Next, what will happen? Yes, very good. Water will begin to boil and yes, it will become water vapor or steam. Very good. It's quite common, right? Okay. Now, we took ice, then we heated that ice and that ice melted into water. Again, we heated water and it became steam. What is the physical state of ice? Solid. Okay, very good. And what about water? It is liquid. And what about steam? It is gas. So, what's happening here? Yes, the state is changing, right? Ice melts to water, water boils to steam. The state is changing, isn't it? First solid to liquid, then liquid to gas. Now, let me ask you one thing. Can this steam again become water? That means, can a gas change to liquid again? Yes, how? Okay, very good. On cooling, yes. See, now the steam is very much hot, isn't it? If we cool that steam, we get water in liquid state. We have learned it in our smaller classes. Very good. So, one more thing. Can water become ice again? Why not? If it is kept in freezer, that means if it is again and again cooled, it will become ice again. So, this is actually change of state, isn't it? The state of this object. Which object is taken here? Water. The solid state of water is called ice. Liquid state is called water. And the gaseous state is called steam or water vapor. Okay. So, here we see the change of state of water. Okay. So, can you complete this flowchart? Yes. You have to fill up this flowchart. Solid, when heated, becomes, the arrow mark is given to the middle box, isn't it? What should be written there? Yes, liquid. Solid, when heated, becomes liquid. And again, when it is heated, becomes gas. And in the reverse order, gas, when cooled, very good. When cooled, becomes liquid. And again, if it is cooled, it becomes solid again. Okay. So, how has the state changed here? Or what is the reason for change of state here? Yes, we have heated ice at first, it has become water. Again, we heated water and became steam. So, we have given heat energy in order to change the state of this object, right? Okay. Now, see this picture. There are three boxes, and again, let me tell you, these small balls represent the tiny particles of that substance. What will happen to the energy of particles when a solid is changed to liquid and again liquid to gas? Energy increases, very good. And what about the distance between the particles? Yes, the distance between the particles increases. What about attraction between the particles? Very good. As we have discussed earlier, the attraction between the particles decreases. And one more thing, what about the movement of particles? Increases. When solid becomes liquid and liquid becomes gas, it keeps on increasing. Very good. Okay. So, we have come across change of state of object. So, what we call the process of change of state from a solid to a liquid? Or what is the process called when a solid changes to liquid? It is liquefaction. See here, it is liquefaction. And again, when liquid changes to gas, the process is called vaporization. And in the reverse order, when the gas changes to liquid, it is called, you have studied in the earlier classes, condensation. Very good, condensation. And when liquid changes to solid again, it is called solidification. Okay. Can solid change to gas directly? Or gas change to solid directly? Have you heard of camphor or naphthalene balls? Okay. What is the speciality of that substances? Yes, very good. Camphor is in solid state. It becomes, or it changes directly to vapor in the gaseous state. Okay. So, when solid changes directly to gas, that process is called sublimation. It's a new word for you. Sublimation. Sublimation is the process when a solid changes directly to gas. And when gas changes to solid, it is called solidification again. Okay, it is becoming solid. So, in that sense, it is solidification. So, we shall repeat it once again. When solid changes to liquid, it is called liquefaction. When liquid changes to gas, it is called vaporization. When gas changes to solid, it is called solidification. Now, in the reverse order, when solid changes to gas. It is sublimation. When gas changes to liquid, it is condensation. And when liquid changes to solid, it is solidification. Okay. Have you noted these in your science diary? Very good. So friends, now it's time to wind up our class today. What all things we have come across in today's class? Yes, we have found the answer for the question, why are objects found in solid state, liquid state and in gaseous state. And we have seen another process, isn't it? Change of state. Objects can change their state from one state to another. And each change of state is termed with a new word. We have come across five different words. Which all are they? Liquefaction. Yes, vaporization. Yes, solidification. Then, okay, condensation and sublimation. Very good. There is a small assignment for you. This is a table 4-3 given in page number 58 of your textbook. You have to complete this table. What all are given in this table? Yes, in the first column, the features of particles are given. Movement of particles, distance between particles, attraction between particles and energy of particles. There are four other columns in which four change of states are given. In the first one, when solid changes into liquid. Second, when liquid changes into gas. Third, when gas changes into liquid. And the fourth one, when solid changes to gas. What you have to do is, you have to analyze and think what happens to the movement, energy, attraction and distance of the particles during each change of state. That is, whether it is increasing or decreasing. And fill up the columns accordingly. Okay, have you noted the question in your science diary? Very good. You have to fill up this table and send it to your chemistry teacher. There are some other concepts in our chapter. We shall learn that concepts in our next class. See you again.